My name is Troy Hendrickson. I am the creator of Aunt Mary Pat, and my hope with this documentary is that I can kind of introduce people to me. I've been doing this for over 3 years, and it just kind of happened. And I really, kind of made the character real and so accessible. And people, I think, thought that that was me as a person. They were like, when are you at the Acme? When can I come down to visit you? Where are you? Where are you right now? Where do you and Uncle Larry live? And all this kind of stuff. And it was very cool. And then it got to the point where I realized that I was being treated differently. Like, if I were to go out as Aunt Mary Pat and then go back out to the same place as Troy, I would get two separate treatments, because Aunt Mary Pat was the famous, successful one, and I was just, a person. So, with the hopes of this documentary, I can kind of introduce people to me, tell people how I started this, where I came from, who I am as a person, and hopefully we can kind of like shed some light. And I would love for people to know who I am and how much this character means to me, and how hard I worked at this to really make it something special. And I'm so glad that Aunt Mary Pat means so much to so many different people, and people love her, and she's so tangible, and she's a part of people's family in a really special way, and that warms my heart. But there's so much I want to do, and I feel like with this documentary, it'll really shed some light on that, hopefully. Oh, it's a one. Hey, you guys. Hope you're all doing good after the big game. Wasn't it exciting?
I was very excited and up all friggin' night, hungover as shit this morning, had to get up all early, and, you know, I swear, it was so loud, it sounded like they were striking the Liberty Bell again.
When the first video came out, I did it as a joke. I was making fun of my mom. You know, she calls me up when the Eagles won the Super Bowl, or I called her because I knew she was out at the bar and she was celebrating. She was so excited. I knew she was going to be so happy. And I'm like, Mom, are you so happy? You're at... You know, the Eagles just won the Super Bowl, and it's, like, you know, amazing for you.
When I first saw the Aunt Mary Pat video, I wanted to kill Troy. Oh, my God. I was like, take that thing down. Everybody at work's going to, like, see it. I could be in trouble. Like, just get that thing off there. I don't want it on there. Yeah, I was really upset. I was going to kill him. I was going to kill Troy.
Really? It was just hilarious. It was just so funny. And then once you've realized, you know, most of it was about Sue, so, you know, and then the character you just took off more and more with, it's, yeah.
I'm like, I don't know what to think of this. I'm like, I think he's making fun, but he's being serious. So I was a little drawn back, but it was funny.
When I saw the first Aunt Mary Pat video, I laughed hysterically because I knew who he was portraying.
I would say that I've seen you create content just as good as that, if not better, over and over again. But I noticed immediately, like as the views were exponentially going up, I noticed that you were tapping into something that was really special, but authentic and honest. Like, I immediately thought of Mom and something that we would always joke about our whole life. That was a huge part of our sense of humor. But I noticed that it connected with an audience in a really special and unique way. And I didn't know that it was going to turn into to what it eventually did with shows and marketing. I just knew immediately that it was really special.
And she's like, Sean, no. I'm going to have to move Dallas, buying up all the gear because they're going to jack the prices up tomorrow now that the Eagles won. And I was like, oh, my God. So I wanted to poke fun at her and in a lighthearted way. And then I, you know, put on this old wig I had that looks nothing like her hair, but it just reminded me of an aunt's hair. And then, you know, put on the lashes. And then I kind of like, you know, I didn't want it to be like exactly word for word her. I wanted it to be like, you know, something that was accessible to a bunch of different people. So it wasn't just my mom. It was like somebody's aunt that they all could relate to. And so I came up with Aunt Mary Pat. And it just kind of like, it came so naturally. I did it all, you know, I did it all very quickly. I thought it was funny. I put it on my personal, you know, Facebook page. And then like, within a few minutes, like, people were liking, commenting, and they were asking to share it, and they shared it, and then it was like, within a few hours, it was like 10,000 views, 20,000, then by the next day, it was like 300,000 views. People were like all over talking about Aunt Mary Pat, and I was like, this is insane. Like, I literally did not know what to expect from it, but I was so happy that people were finding it funny, and of course, my mom flips out, and she's like, you asshole, everyone knows about me and they're gonna talk about me and like, take it down now. And I was like, Mom, this is insane. I think when it got like, everyone was so excited and it was such a fun moment. And we just assumed like, this is, you know, it's not gonna be a thing. And then there was like, everyone kept messaging me about knowing more about this character. So we made the Facebook page. I started coming out with more videos and diversifying it a little bit more. And it just kept growing and growing and growing. And I was just like so overwhelmed by it.
I was so happy for Troy. Like, I just couldn't believe it because he was like, you know, 1,000 views, 10,000 views, you know, 1,000,000 views, whatever. I was just, it just made me happy. I cried. I was, and then so excited for Troy because it's always, he always wanted to do something like this. And it just felt very heartwarming, I guess. Yeah, I was just overwhelmed, to be honest.
My drag room, you can see. A lot of stuff in here. So, like, first and foremost, my family means everything to me. Obviously, most people know by now that the character is based off my mom. And, you know, without her, I don't know where I would be in my life. And the hardest thing for me is knowing, you know, how hard it was for her growing up and just knowing everything that she went through and everything that she sacrificed to make sure that our lives weren't as hard as hers were.
I had a very loving mother, very close to my brothers. We grew up very poor, so it was hard that way because we didn't have a lot of money, but my mom had a lot of love. So we never really went a lot of places, so we were always together, so to speak. One aunt would take us away as kids down the beach, and that was a big deal to us. So we didn't get much for Christmas. My mom didn't have the money. Not her fault, because my dad left when she was 2 months pregnant with me. They actually, one aunt told her that, you know, I should have been aborted. It's emotional, I guess. Because the way we had to grow up, free lunches. Didn't have a real nice house with a lot of nice stuff in it. But other than that, my mom was very loving, and I didn't really know my dad too much till later in life and at the end of his life when I had to take care of him. So that's kind of our life in a nutshell. I had to stop going to school to work, help pay bills.
And, you know, for me, my brother, and my sister, we grew up, we never knew that there was not enough money. You know, we never had a feeling. The Christmases were always huge. Birthdays were always huge. You know, we never went without. And I didn't realize until I got older that sometimes that meant my parents had to go without. But they wanted to make sure that, you know, we had everything growing up. And, you know, I'm just so grateful for the person that my mother is.
As a kid, you only know your family. So I just thought that's how the world was. Like, I thought everyone had a brother who was choreographing like dances and was an entertainer. Like, I didn't have any data. I didn't know there were other families out there that were different. And then probably in like my mid-20s, it all clicked that we're really special. But I just remember being pretty quiet and keeping to myself and knowing that you were really entertaining, I guess. I knew that we...
Being the older sister, very annoying. I was young, trying to do my thing with my friends, and he was always there, under my feet. Always had to take care of him, babysit him. LT needed something. You have to stop what you're doing and do for LT. So our relationship growing up younger, he was just annoying to me. He was the younger brother that got everything he wanted and was annoying to me. And I had to take time for my friends to stay at home and babysit him. So it wasn't till we grew older that is when our relationship really became pretty special. Like, and me having kids, he was always there, you know, for my kids and taking them places and never forgot a birthday or a holiday and just seeing him grow up into the man that he was and being there for my kids, I respected him so much.
I wanted to make sure they had everything. Because it's hard growing up with nothing. So I kind of overdid it, I guess, with Christmas and birthdays and taking them places, doing a lot of stuff with them. My mom always had to work, so I wanted to make sure I did everything with them. I worked actually night shift so I could be home with my kids, Troy and Tyler and Arlene. So like I said, I just wanted to make sure Christmas was extra special. Birthdays were extra special, and like I said, taking them everywhere, doing everything with their school functions, because my mom really couldn't when we were kids, so I made sure a point to do everything with their schools.
I love growing up in a big family, and our family was huge. My dad's side of the family, he was one of eight. We were grandkids, like one of 24. Always cousins around, always something to do. There was always a game or a show or, you know, something that was to the effect of that. Like, there was always endless entertainment. You know, one of my first memories, you know, being a kid is my grandfather loved Patsy Cline, and we would always listen to it. And I got a microphone for Christmas one year, and we plugged it into this old speaker, and I sang Walking After Midnight on this old microphone, and I made my family watch, sit down and watch. I gave a performance, you know, and that was the first song I really remember performing and, you know, being into and liking it.
Yes, I bought Troy a cheap little microphone. It might have been $10, and it plugged into our big screen TV, and he acted like he was some big famous singer. He sung word for word. We were all sitting on the couch, and he thought that microphone might have been a $1 million microphone. That was probably one of the best gifts I ever got him.
My first memory, I mean, was, and we have a picture of it, you connected by microphone to the old stereo in the house and, you know, singing songs, and we had to sit then and watch you perform and dance. And that was a young age, probably five or so. And just everything you've done has always been a performance.
It's just funny things that come back to you like that. And then, you know, as I got older, every family party, you know, that's an instant audience. You know, they're all right there. And I always wanted to perform. I always enjoyed making people smile and laugh. And I get that, you know, from my dad a lot. He always did karaoke, always singing songs, telling jokes, making people laugh and entertained. I loved it. And I wanted to be like that too. And I remember, like, every party I had to put on a show. And I remember one year, I think I was 11. I think it was right before sixth grade or something like that. And I made my mom go to Sears and buy me a blue Speedo. And I was obsessed with Speedo. I was a little chubby, you know, I was just obsessed. I don't know. It was like a costume to me. And I put it on and I did like a dance. You know, I wore a shirt, of course, and, you know, my little Speedo and boots or something like that. And I did a dance to, it was a Britney Spears song or something. I mean, everybody watched, and it was just, you know, I don't know. Everyone was so supportive, and, you know, it just made me happy to be able to do that. Ever since I was little, I was always dancing to the Spice Girls, Mariah Carey, like, just wanted to, you know, be that glamorous and, you know, entertain people, and I just had such a good time. You know, even with my friend Christian growing up and doing, like, little mini shows in his garage, was just like, it didn't matter if anyone was watching. I was living in the moment.
So growing up, Troy and I, we were definitely brothers and friends, but we had our own separate lives. And I think I was pretty quiet. I liked to do constructive things with Legos. And I remember Troy would always come up with these different shows and ideas. This is when we were really little. And he had a friend named Christian, a neighbor, and they would hang out, and they had this garage at Christian's house, and above the garage there was this stage, and I don't know why it was there. It was covered in cobwebs. No one used it. It might have even just been a platform. And I remember going over there a few times and just watching them. And I think, like, the first Spice Girls album came out, and they loved the album. And they would choreograph every single song on the album. They would make these different dances to each song. And I didn't know what to make of it. I was really little, four or five. But it was just, I guess, funny to me to see. I didn't know about show business or entertainment. It was just like two friends hanging out. And they used this dusty stage to, like, entertain thousands of people that weren't there yet. But he knew, I don't know, like, it was just amazing to see that. I just didn't know it yet. But when we got our first video camera, that's when I really started to see something fun. We loved filming everything we did. And one of our inspirations was MTV Jackass. We would try to, like, jump in bushes. But one time we got our dad to play along, and we were trying to be like Bam Margera and shave his head, but he was bald. He actually needed a haircut. So he was sitting at the table reading like a newspaper, and we snuck up behind him and covered his head with shaving cream and started shaving his head. And he was just saying like, oh no, why are you doing this? Classic acting dad. And it was, that was, those were the most cherished memories for me growing up. Just having that video camera, coming up with a story, and then shooting it in order because we had no editing software. That was one of the best memories that we had together, I think, early on.
Well, actually, every time, they had birthday parties every year between him and his brother. And every time any event happened up there, Troy would have to go out there and perform. He would just have to, he had to work his way up to do something before the party got started. So whether or not he sang and danced and just, you know, perform in front of everybody, he just had to make sure he had his 5 minutes. The one memory that I can really stand out to me is, I think he was 10 or 11, I'm not sure which age it was, but he came out in a Speedo, just had the Speedo on and stood out and said, I got to inform, I got to entertain, stood out there in the living room with this Speedo, and I do believe probably it was a Spice Girl song, one of them. He just stood out there and performed, so I saw that's where his performance started.
Oh, Troy was the entertainment of the family. No matter what, we had picnics or any kind of functions or holidays, he performed for us all the time. I mean, back to my earliest memories, I can remember Troy always performing for us, either him or his friends and him or somebody.
I really got into performing seriously after that because I went to Cab Calloway School of the Arts, middle school and high school, and I just knew I had to go there. I knew, like, it was just, there wasn't telling me no. I knew that's where I needed to be. I knew I had to perform and I had to be around people who were like me. And I, like, as soon as I got to that school, I fell in love with just entertainment and performing and, you know, being in little shows. And I think that kind of led me into the direction to drag performance because I was always cast in these little roles. And, you know, they were like, we're short a girl. Troy, do you want to, you know, put on a wig and do the comedy line or whatever? I was like, of course. Like, yeah, I'm not going to say no. And, you know, had little mini solos. And I remember I had a teacher in high school, when we did Fame, and you had to do a singing audition, an acting audition, and a dance audition. And I was, you know, I was in the acting class, and I knew that that would be no problem. Wasn't a very good singer, wasn't a very good dancer, but I auditioned, and the teacher came up to me afterwards, and she was like, I just want to let you know, you're not a very good dancer, but you have something. There is just something about you, and I don't care if we have to put you in the back. We're gonna make you, you know, you're in this play. You have to be in this play. And I was like, you know, like, yes, I'm not a very good dancer, but it was happy to be validated and see that someone was, you know, watching and appreciative of what you had to offer.
I was at a funeral, my uncle's funeral. Troy said, Mom, I want to go to this school called Cab Calloway. And I'm like, when? He goes, Mom, I have the tryouts are tonight. And this was after he goes, we have to leave the viewing early. And I said, what do you got to do? And he goes, I have to try out in front of these people. So he goes home, he throws some stuff together. We go to Cab Calloway, wait in line. Troy had to go in front of like six people, I do believe, and try out for this school. And I'm thinking, oh God, he's never going to get in this. I'm praying he did, because he could tell how excited Troy was about getting into this school. But there was a lot of people there, I remember. A lot of people were all put together. I mean, dressed as characters, dressed, you know, top notch, I guess. And they were all organized. So he went home, like I said, within 10 minutes, threw some stuff together. We headed towards the school, like I said, and they said, you did best out of all the kids tonight. I remember he had to do something with spaghetti, like spaghetti here, spaghetti there, spaghetti everywhere. And they said, this kid he's got something. He's got talent. So next thing you know, we got a letter in the mail, and he got in. One of my happiest days, I was in good school. He went from 6th to 12th grade there. And I was a little nervous because I'm like, you don't know any kids. You don't know any. Because I thought he would just go with, you know, you go to this school and you're, you know, 5th through or kindergarten through 5th. Then you go to this school, 6th through. Then you go to that school through high school with all the same kids you always go with. And I'm like, you know, Troy, are you going to be okay? Like, you don't know any kids here. And he goes, Mom, I really want to go to the school. I have to go to the school. I want to get in this school. And we got a letter and he got in. I was very happy.
You know, from there, I went to college at Columbia College Chicago and had a great experience in film and television, which I'm blessed I did, even though I dropped out and, you know, wasted a lot of money. But I met a lot of great people that I'm still friends with to this day. And I really needed that experience to go out and be on my own and do something outside of the area and learn new things and, you know, be a part of something bigger than myself. And I learned, you know, editing skills and filming skills and camera and, you know, digital media and all that kind of stuff, which flash forward a few years would prepare me for Aunt Mary Pat. But after I got, you know, back from school, I, you know, worked little dead-end jobs and did whatever I had to do to make money to survive. But I really learned about drag from there, and I fell in love with drag and, you know, the costumes and the hair and the glamour. And when RuPaul's Drag Race came out, that really, you know, changed. I was like, you know what? I want to do that. I can do that. Not realizing how hard it is to be a professional drag queen or drag performer. And I tried it, put on a little lipstick, you know, some mascara, a little costume, and I thought I was, you know, the best. But you learn over time that it's just beginners, you know, you start out and you're like super confident for no reason. But I fell in love and I really worked very hard at it and I really tried really hard.
I just felt honored being Troy's mom, being at a drag show. Obviously there's a lot of competition out there. Troy's came a long way from his first show till now. Because everybody says, oh, he looks just like you with lipstick on, you know. He puts a lot of hard work, blood, sweat, and tears into the acts, the costumes, to everything. I said he really has it because he's a very good entertainer. He knows how to keep people entertained. And I like all the competitions he goes in because, like I said, he works hard at what he does. And I love seeing him perform. I can watch his shows over and over and over.
Oh, I just love the costumes and the makeup and how they performed. I mean, just seeing how you come out and you're just somebody different and you can express yourself through being somebody different or that character that you want to be or that singer that you're going to be. I mean, it just... They're mind blowing. It's just the first time you see one, it's really awesome.
I think when I came out, you know, growing up gay, you always feel a little different. I looking back, I was always, you know, everyone should have known I was gay. But I, you know, that wasn't a thought in my head until I was, you know, 12, 13, and then I realized, yeah, and then I was just full force, you know, out and proud, didn't care what anybody thought.
It was a Friday night after bowling. Troy told me, he was crying and depressed, or, you know, I said, what's wrong with you? You're not acting your stuff. You never cry. You're never depressed. You know, did somebody hit you? Did somebody do something? Are you fighting with a friend? You know, what's going on with you? And you're like, and then Troy's like, Mom, I'm gay. And I'm like, oh my God, I started crying. I said, get your stuff together. We're going over to see Dr. Taylor. Somebody must have touched you. Something happened. And I'm crying. And, you know, I called Dr. Taylor on the phone. And we went over and, you know, talked to Dr. Taylor. I made an appointment. She said, come right over. You know, like I said, we were, you know, I was in tears. I thought something happened. Somebody touched him, you know. And Dr. Taylor said, I don't see anything wrong. All I see is a good mother and son relationship. If he's able to tell you this at 15, most people either go to their grave with it or they don't tell anybody till a lot later in life, not at 15. So, But I wouldn't change it for the world. I love Troy dearly. I honor him being gay, and they could come out at 15 and tell me. It's still an honor to this day, and I still share that story.
Well, like I said, I used to get and pick him up all the time, and he got to the spot, I would pick him up, we'd go do something, he would end up spending the night, you know, at my house with my mom and my dad, which is his mother, his grandmother and grandfather, and he would spend the night, and I had this closet that was a mirror closet. And back then, back in the 80s and the 90s, I had high heel shoes, high heel boots, and he would just put them on and entertain himself in front of the mirror, just singing and dancing and prancing around. So I'm sure that's where he got his love for fashion, high heels, dressing up, doing makeup. We would just play around, and I just let him be who he was. It didn't bother me that, you know, it was makeup for girls. He was him, I was me, and we would just do whatever we felt like doing.
You know, the harder thing for me was growing up, and you know, I always felt different. You know, I always, I didn't feel, you know, like a boy. I didn't feel like a girl. I just felt like me. You know, I felt like there was no one like me, and I was always weird and lonely and, you know, just out of place. And it wasn't until I got older and I met people, different people, that I realized, you know, I'm a non-binary person. So it's easy for me to dress up and put on feminine things or masculine things because I feel both of them at different times. And, I have to, you know, my family is so supportive that I really am blessed, and I understand the privilege that I have with coming out and being accepted, because not everyone does. And I think the best part about meeting people through Aunt Mary Pat are the people who come up and say, thank you for opening my eyes and changing my mind and really showing me different kinds of people, because you helped me accept my daughter who came out. You helped me accept my, you know, my sibling who is a trans person, or, you know, regardless of what it is, it's truly, truly just, I mean, that alone is what makes me happy. Right before Aunt Mary Pat came out, I started, you know, really getting into performing a lot more, bigger venues, more money, started producing my own shows, you know, casting and all this stuff that I was really interested in. And I thought this may be my year for drag. And then Aunt Mary Pat happened. And it just literally, like, it changed my entire life. I had never done anything, you know, that would prepare me for what Aunt Mary Pat did and became.
What is the best entertainment that someone like Jeff wants? Aunt Mary Pat!
And I really had no one to tell me what was right, what was wrong, what I should ask for, what, you know, I just said yes to everything because I was so excited to be doing what I love to do and have people appreciate it. So I started doing events, and the first event I did, I was in Delco, and it was a meet and greet. I did it for $100. There were 300 people there. I didn't know what to expect. And then, you know, afterwards, thankfully, my partner, Danny, he was like, you deserve more than that, you know, than that. You really need to, you know, figure out better deals or something like that. So then I literally, like, after that first event, you know, it just got around that I was bringing people in, and videos were taking off and everything was doing really good. And then, you know, I really started to, you know, ask for more because I was bringing in more. I could guarantee it. You know, I was really doing it. But, like, I mean, there was events, and I mean, there are shady people out there. And luckily, I have a pretty good sense of, you know, I get a pretty good vibe. I can really sense what people are all about, if they're genuine or if they're, you know.
The first show we went to, the very first show of Aunt Mary Pat, I cried. I couldn't believe it. I literally just looked at the crowd. I couldn't believe there was cops, like, directing traffic, and there was a line wrapped around the whole entire building, and the place was already packed. They would let, like, two in, two out, two in, two out, And I'm like, there's no way they're all here for my son. It was overwhelming. I was happy. Like I said, I was crying. And I just felt like he's doing what he loves to do. He likes entertaining people. He likes making people happy. He takes a lot of pride in his work. And I don't care if there's 10 people there or there's 500. Like I said, it's just overwhelming. Like I said, it just made me so happy. And I just said, wow, like all these people were here for my son, Troy, so.
Oh my goodness, I've been to so many. The first one, I couldn't even remember which one was the first one because I've been to so many of them. But each one is just funny, hilarious, and it's so down to earth, and the things that Aunt Mary Pat talks about is, you know, just keeps you moving. It keeps everyone involved in. I don't see anybody getting bored with it or say, oh, I've seen this one before. Being at so many of them, I can say that each one is always something different at them.
Well, the first show I went to, it was probably early summer. I went with them and I'm like, there was a lot of people there. We were in small, at this point, we were small, maybe bar time things, wall-to-wall people. And I was just watching everybody's reaction. And it was amazing just to see how much they liked the Aunt Mary Pat.
No, I think it's one thing to see something happen on social media. Like, you can look at the views and you're like, yeah, that's amazing. Like, a lot of people are watching this. But when I saw humans in a space, like when I saw people come to a place to watch the show, that was really special to me because I saw people enjoying Troy the way I have forever, but like many different people. So it was like, it was just seeing that joy that I've had just resonate with so many different people finally. It was like a sense of relief, like to see all of that. And I think what really hit me, I don't remember exactly which show, but just after the show, seeing people line up to talk to him and maybe get a t-shirt, but definitely get like a picture, right? Like that was really, really special to see. Love the free drinks. I love to go to a place and get as many free drinks as I want. That was awesome. And the casino show, it was at Chester Harris. I don't know if it was the first or second one, but just to see rows and rows of people just waiting and talking to each other and like applauding when he finally walked out. Like that was amazing to see. Like you go to a concert and you see that, but you're wondering what the musician is like behind the scenes. And the Harris show is when it really clicked for me because we went behind the stage and, you know, we went to see the artist. Like it was like a VIP pass. But I love this person. They're my brother. I get to see that. I remember getting really drunk at the Harris show, being in the front row, and then it all hitting me. And then I'm like, David, you have to escort me to the bathroom because I don't know if I'm going to be able to walk. Like, and standing up and turning around and seeing just a sea of people staring was terrifying and amazing at the same time. It started in those little bar gigs, and that was really cool. Like that reminded me of the drag shows. Just different energy, more people. But when we, like at the casino, that's to see it at that scale, to have all of our family there, that was a really touching moment.
But either way, you know, there are people who backstabbed me, lied, cheated me out of money, you know, pretended like they didn't offer me stuff. They always wanted to talk on the phone, so there was no written proof. So then I, you know, did everything through email. People were like, can I call you? I'm like, no, you can email me though. After we get everything, you know, settled out, then we can talk on the phone. There were people who would get me to guarantee, like, ask me what money I wanted without telling me what they were charging for tickets or how many tickets they were selling. And then the producer or the, you know, bar manager who booked the show ended up getting paid more than I did for the events that I was pulling in. And I'm sure there were people out there who saw how many shows I was doing and, you know, how many people were going, and probably thought, wow, you know, this guy has money. But I mean, the first year, honestly, no, I was doing 12 shows a week and, you know, making less than, you know, some people do. But touring was really difficult because May of the first year, after I started like scheduling things pretty far into advance, I ended up quitting my day job and I started doing this full time. And I went around and, you know, I was pretty much working Wednesday through Sunday every week. Shows every night, private appearances. I was going everywhere. Like these first, I got these books and I kept them because I wasn't sure if I would ever need them. But I started writing down everything in the books and I started keeping track of everything. And I literally had, I don't know if you can see, events every single day, to the point where I had to schedule time. Oh, I switched to this book. I was like, there's nothing impressive there. I literally had to, you know, schedule time with my family, all these events, commercials, meetings, promos. I was performing. I had to, you know, schedule time for my friends. I had to schedule time for my family. I had to schedule a date night with my partner. I had to schedule time to have dinner with my mom, my brother, my sister. I had to book, you know, holidays, vacations well in advance. I had to make sacrifices and not be there for things. And, you know, that was really hard for me because I am so close to my friends. I'm so close to my family. And then just to not have the time because I was working so much. But grateful, and I know everyone understood, but it really did wear on me, and I exhausted myself. There was a time I was really exhausted, and you know, I was performing, traveling, working back to back nonstop, and it was a few days before Christmas, so all the holiday rush and all that kind of stuff on top of it, and I was doing a show. It was two shows in one night. And by the second show, I had almost lost my voice. I was exhausted. I try to give 100% of myself every time I do a show and every time I have something to do, I try to give 100%. And even though I was giving 100% of myself at that time, I was probably at my like a 60% capacity because I was so, I just felt, you know, there are times when I'm performing, I'm doing a show and people are laughing and into it, but I know that it's not my best. And I was like, why am I exhausting myself and working so hard if I can't even, you know, give the best show that I know I can give? So it was really after that, around that time, that I had met Joel. And Joel was the first person to book me and, you know, pay me what I was worth and show me, you know, the money that I could be making from this and show me, you know, what to ask for, how to ask for it. And, you know, after I met him, I really trusted him and I knew that he would be the perfect person to be my manager. And I was just, went on a limb and I said, Joel, can you manage me?
Hi, this is Joel Richardson of Soul Joel Productions and Soul Joel's Comedy Club and Lounge. I've had the privilege of knowing Troy for just over 3 years and managing Aunt Mary Pat exclusively for just over 2. I got to know Troy through Gino Vento of Gino's Cheesesteaks in South Philly, one of the Philly cheesesteak moguls. We had Troy as one of our guests at our podcast, and one of the things that I love getting to know about Troy is that he's done drag his entire life, different characters, and when he discovered Aunt Mary Pat and created it based off his mom, the Queen of Delco, the Phillies won the Super Bowl and all of Aunt Mary Pat's videos went viral. But it's not just the talent of making and creating Aunt Mary Pat, it's everything that Troy does behind the scenes to keep Aunt Mary Pat relevant through all the songs and parodies and marketing of the different tours and all the fans keeps coming back in every show. So much that when we opened up in 2019, Aunt Mary Pat was the first artist to sell out not just one show at Soul Joel's, but 4 shows back in 2019. And then in 2020, We created this bigger outdoor space because of the pandemic. And again, Aunt Mary Pat was not just the first artist to sell out one show, but sold out three shows. Very impressive. Can't be more proud to be working with Troy, Aunt Mary Pat, and very excited to see what the future brings.
Touring was a really crazy thing and a crazy time in my life. And I started saving for the national tour all of the room cards for... This is all the places I went. You know what I mean? This is every place that's over an hour drive from home, I usually stay. And, you know, to all these places that I went to and stayed, and, you know, it's wild to... I always wanted to travel. I always wanted to entertain. I always wanted a job like that. And to finally be able to do it, to travel, you know, in these places, like, I've always wanted to go to California, Napa Valley, and then to be able to do it for work. It's just like a, you know, a really beautiful thing for me, to, you know, be able to go to Florida and visit family I hadn't seen in years because work took me down there. You know, just to be able to meet new people and, you know, experience new things. Like, it was such a rush for me, you know, for someone who worked for 10 years as a drag performer at these dead-end jobs, you know, really scrounging pennies together, overdrafting my account just to put gas in my car so I could make it to a drag show, to make $35, and, you know, half of that you have to pay for parking and a drink. And it's just, you know, I'm so blessed to be here and be able to do what I love to do in this moment. But, like, I think that a common misconception is I fell into this and didn't work at it. And going to art school, working as a professional drag performer, doing videos, you know, for the past, you know, 10 years solidly. And that was for free. You know, I was working these jobs. I didn't have any money. I, you know, got into really bad credit card debt paying for drag. I, you know, really struggled. I struggled. Had $20 a week for groceries, had to make that work, make it stretch. You know, had a car. I drove to a car dealership lot because I said, this car is dead and I need a car. So whatever you have to charge me, you know. And then to be able to do what you love to do and take care of your family while doing it. And there's no better feeling in the world. Like, it's just, my hard work came full circle. And that was probably like the best moment for me with this job and to do Aunt Mary Pat.
So first of all, I never knew there were so many places in Delco. I couldn't tell you where they were. We just know that we ended up being there. Some of them were bigger than others. Some of them were smaller than others. But the whole audience was full. And everybody was just so entertained by Aunt Mary Pat. And throughout the whole time, they're just saying, oh my God, I love her, I love her. Oh my God, it's so nice, it's so wonderful to have this time to be entertained by someone that is part of our family. And I just couldn't believe, and I'm just like thinking, wow. I'm like, what's going on? I'm like, Aunt Mary Pat is part of their family. It's not my family, you know, something that we did as a family, but going out and seeing everybody enjoy themselves. So many people go, oh my God, you're just so lucky to be related to Aunt Mary Pat. And I'm sure it's so funny and it's nice. And I'm like, yeah, it is. And I'm like, but you guys are so nice to Aunt Mary Pat. So it's part of your family.
I couldn't believe when he was on a national tour and we went to California, that people way in California and way in Florida, the crowds there. Because I was thinking, I didn't know what it was going to be like. I didn't know if there was going to be like one or two people there or there was going to be hundreds. Like, I wasn't sure what to expect. And I was just very surprised how many people that were there way over in California that came for an Aunt Mary Pat show. That's when it really hit home. Like I said, this just isn't in the tri-state area. This is like all over the world. Like, it's everywhere. It was very heart-wrenching.
Oh, I was so excited. Just to see all the people that had came out to support and to see him and the lives he's touched.
We went on every day. I mean, there's a couple of times that we did three events in one day. We went to one, stayed there, left there, went to another, left there and went to another. So there were long days, and that was from 12 o'clock to maybe 10 or 11 at night. So, and in between, just waiting until the times the other ones start. And since there were some of them out in out Philly, and we're down here in the Delco area, we just stayed up there and try to fill in our time. And there has been plenty days of doing that, and over in Jersey, and a lot over further in the Pennsylvania area.
They're very engaged with the character, and they're very excited when the character comes out on stage, when Tori comes out as Aunt Mary Pat, and it's just amazing how many people come over and over, and the repeat people you see at all the functions that support him and just love the character.
The first time I felt like I was successful at doing Aunt Mary Pat, there's a few moments. So the first time that I heard Doing Good on the radio, and people were sending me videos and it was on, like, I was like, this is so surreal. Like, I cannot believe this. The second was probably being on a billboard for the Harris Casino show and just, you know, driving there and seeing your face on the side of the road on a highway. Like, this is so surreal. I had to pull over and take a picture of it because I was so, like, it was just.
When Aunt Mary Pat was a success, I thought from day one, really, but when it started hitting, like, TV, well, the newspaper first, and then it went on, like, live TV, I'm like, holy shit, like, I couldn't believe it. I'm like, oh my God, this Aunt Mary Pat's going somewhere. And then we're almost 3 years later, and it's still going on. I mean, I went to a show the other night, and there was almost 400 people there. It was really amazing. I knew it was going somewhere, like I said, when like it's in the paper, it's on the radio, it's on billboards. When it was on the billboard, I was like, oh my God, like I'm driving up 95, I've never seen it. And I look over and I almost crashed the car. I had to pull over and get pictures. It was crazy.
Craziest thing I probably remember is some fans were really totally, I mean, I know she's a superstar, but we're not talking Brad Pitt or Jennifer Aniston or anything like that. But this being Aunt Mary Pat was sort of their Brad Pitt, Jennifer Aniston. So they were just so happy, and it was like a star. So they were really happy to have somebody within their area they could relate to.
I believe it was at the Milton Theater. I was just in awe. I mean, that's a big known theater, and just how it was packed and people lined up out front down the street. It was just amazing. I just never thought that it would become that big, and it just makes me so proud.
Just before COVID, I saw this, like, I really saw the Aunt Mary Pat show start to expand. You know, Troy was telling me about different cities that were gonna that the show was gonna take place in, and I was thinking, like, this is sort of like a Delco thing. Is this going to resonate with other people? And when I started to hear the shows going well, that got me really excited that this type of comedy show can be appreciated in different parts of the country and the world, hopefully. So I imagined that at first, that, like, okay, new material, different parts of the world, you know, and Troy as Aunt Mary Pat telling different stories, like, oh, I went to California and I tried this wine, and they were, you know, just seeing this story develop as Aunt Mary Pat getting out of Delco and experiencing this. You know, personally, as Troy's brother, knowing the potential that's there, I'd like to see it expand into different characters, different formats. I could even imagine Aunt Mary Pat having sort of like a sitcom, and just seeing what the family life is like. So I'd love to see Aunt Mary Pat in different parts of the world, new material, and I'd love to see Troy as new characters, whatever that means as well.
Okay. Well, after the shows, it's people come up to him, And Aunt Mary Pat's not, okay, my show's done, I'm leaving. He loves his fans. You know, Troy loves the fans to come out. He's generally honest, and he appreciates every one of them. And he will, to his best ability, meet and talk to every one of them that's there that he can do. I don't think that any of them are disappointed. I think they all love meeting him. And I've seen it. It's like crazy sometimes. They're like, me, you know, come after me, you know. So I just think that behind the scenes and when the show's over, the character doesn't just end. The character continues until the very, very last person leaves that place.
Aunt Mary Pat really takes her time with her fan. That's what I like, because, like I said, if there's 10 people there or there's 500, he will take his time. Even if it takes him an extra 2 hours, I've seen almost 1,000 people at the casino. And I mean, they were in line for hours waiting to do autographs and stuff with Aunt Mary Pat. And he talked to every single one that was in line. And he could have cut it off at any time, because they even said, you know, there's a lot of people waiting. You tell me when you want to cut it off. And he waited till he talked to every one of his fans. His fans are everything to him. They mean a lot. He does a lot for them. They do a lot for him. And there's some people that go to every single show from, I'm talking almost 3 years ago, and they said they wouldn't miss a show. You know, his fans are very important to him.
I think the third thing that really, you know, made me feel successful was doing a show at the Queen in Wilmington. You know, having gone to school in Wilmington and seeing shows. And a year before, I saw my favorite band called Delta Ray, and they're an incredible band. Saw them live on my birthday, and I just like was so mesmerized seeing the stage and the setup and all these people. And then a year later, to be performing on that very same stage with a room full of people, you know, there to see you, I cried. And you know, afterwards, me and my friends were on the stage, and we sang A Moment Like This, you know, by Kelly Clarkson. It was silly, but you know, it really, really, truly, I think those three things, you know, a lot of things, but those three things are probably what made me feel good about doing, knowing I'm on the right path and knowing I'm doing what I'm doing. You know, and beyond that, like, just the fans and the people who support you and leave you comments and send you messages about how you're making their day and, you know, what you're doing for them with, you know, your videos and music. And I just don't know, like, there's no better feeling in the world than to be validated and, you know, supported for doing what you love to do. And there's not a day that goes by that I don't check the messages and check the comments and, you know, appreciate and try to respond back to every single person, because it's just... And it wasn't until that following summer I was booked to do a charity event. And everything was normal, fine. The event was planned for months in advance, and I walk in, and it was a karaoke raising money for women in our community who experienced domestic violence. And I'm there to raise money for this, you know, this event. And I walk inside, and you know, the people who came to see Aunt Mary Pat were so happy and hugging and taking pictures. And then about 5 minutes later, the manager pulled me and the organizer aside and said, hey, you know, we have an employee here who's uncomfortable, and we're gonna have to ask you to leave. And I didn't understand at first what was happening until later that I found out that she was a trans woman who thought that Aunt Mary Pat was mocking, I guess, trans people. And that was never my intention. Aunt Mary Pat was never portrayed as a trans character or parroting anything in regards to, you know, trans people. And it set me, it really like took me off guard, because I had never, you know, I've always done drag in the city. I know a lot of bearded drag queens. I know a lot of people who do, you know, caricatures. And it never crossed my mind that that would be something that went through a person's head. And I asked to speak to the employee just to explain that this is what the character's about. You know, I'm gay. I'm a non-binary person. I would never mock trans people. And the manager was like, no, that's not going to happen because she'll only get more mad if she talks to you. And I was like, okay, you know, we'll just leave. And we wrapped up the event, which was terrible because we were trying to raise money for this great fundraiser. And we went somewhere else. And I thought that would be the end of it. You know, I made a status that I had gotten kicked out of the bar. And, you know, I have fans that are, you know, ride or die. They're so supportive. And they had left, I guess, negative reviews on this Facebook page for the place, which then got attention. And then I was contacted for an article. And it was supposed to be a news article. There were several out there, actually. But apparently that this place, they said they were a news publication, but they were really listed as an opinion publication. So it was an attack on me. And it almost ruined my career. And the author, he was vicious, put quotes in there and saying from an unknown source, or, you know, some people say this, but never a specific person who said it, never anything like that. And it literally was the worst week of my life. I thought everything that I'd worked for was going to be over.
That hurt me really bad because Troy's not like that. And hearing this guy speak, and it was all lies, like, and if you're not a liar and you're not like that type of person, it hurt, especially as a mother, to watch Troy cry. And he put this video on Facebook, and I didn't even know he put the video on, and I was in the same car with him. And after watching it, I just couldn't stop crying. To this day, I still watch it and cry, because for somebody to set out to try to ruin his career or ruin, you know, everything about Aunt Mary Pat, when Troy, he's a gay man himself. And for this guy to just say all these lies, and of course, like, he's big in the Philadelphia community, this guy, and people would, you know, were believing him. And that wasn't Troy at all. And Troy has a big following, and me being his mother, I mean, how do I protect and take up for him? Because they're going to say, oh, that's just his mom, you know. But I just can't see other people setting out to hurt somebody that bad and to try to ruin his career.
I was ashamed because I was afraid that my kids would Google my name, and that's the first thing that comes up. I was embarrassed that this is what I would be known for. I was afraid that this would be the end of my career. And I was grateful because my family, my friends, you know, people that worked with me were very supportive and stood up for me and knew that this was not true. And I just... It was a very, very dark time in my life. I thought I would lose work, and I did. I was supposed to do a tour date in Canada in 2020. That got canceled because the promoters found the article and didn't want it to negatively affect them. I was doing a show, and they had a meeting with me about the article and about what happened. Before they would hire me, people just stopped, you know, booking me in certain communities, and it was rough. We did rebound, you know. There's no press is bad press type of thing, but, you know, I really felt bad because I didn't want anyone to have that opinion of me when it's not true, and I didn't want anyone to think that way about me. I didn't want my kids to think that way about me, and I didn't want anyone to think that it was okay to be transphobic or anything like that, because it's not, and I'm not. It was a real learning experience, and luckily it only grew from there. And I have to thank the people that stood by me and really, you know, helped me get through that, because after that moment, and that was within the first year, you know, everything kind of really took off, and I did a better job at being very transparent and, you know, letting people know where I stand and what I stand for. And the big old Wawa Hoogie, you can never go wrong. On $2 Tuesdays, I'm the queen of customer service down at the Acme. But if you see me at self-checkout, I might just hurt somebody. I love a strong mimosa or a big box of wine, but I'll have a shot of Tharball for a really good time. The music was a huge part of Aunt Mary Pat, and that kind of happened very early on in March. A guy reached out to me. His name is Ken Sullivan, goes by Kendall King, and he said he had an idea for a song. And I was like, okay, sure. And in April, I met his mom, and she said he was so excited. And then in May, we finally got a chance to record it. He came down to Delaware. And, we hit it off, you know, really well and kind of vibed the same way. And we recorded this song called Doing Good. And then it came out in July, in the summertime, perfect time. And I absolutely fell in love. And I could not believe that it was me singing a song. And Ken, you know, wrote it, pieced together some of my sayings and told this whole story. And it, like, it shot to number 12 on the iTunes dance charts, sold some 500 copies in the first week, thousands of streams, and it was so crazy to have people listening to your music and be so, like, just to love it. And, you know, I was just, I could not ask for anything better. And, we did a few more songs, a Christmas song, which I love the holidays, so that's right up my alley. Huge Mariah Carey fan, so I love, you know, doing Christmas. And then at the beginning of 2018, I knew I wanted to do an album, and Ken was on board. And, he obviously has to get paid for his work, and we want to make sure we can put together the best album and, you know, take photos, which my good friend Alex Ortiz did, designed the album cover and did all that. And we did a Kickstarter, and, you know, I set the goal for $5,000, which will cover all of our costs for promotional materials and production and artwork and all that kind of stuff and video. We reached our goal, and, you know, it was thanks to the supporters, you know, people who are fans of mine or enjoy the music. We raised the money within a few weeks, and we were able to, you know, finish our goal and meet our goal and finish the album. And that's where Talk of the Township came from. And, it really, like, I was just so happy that people were so supportive. And our first song we did from that, you know, the album After Doing Good and Touchdown was Down the Shore. And we filmed the video at my friend Kevin's business called The Shore House in Wildwood. And it was just perfect. You know, it just felt, it was a perfect day. My friend Steve filmed the video, and, you know, he's done all my videos since then, and he's just a great person to work with. My Aunt Trina was there with me.
I love the music. I just couldn't believe, the words, and it really keeps the show going. It's very entertaining. I love them all, to be honest with you, because everything, Doing Good, I love that, because I always say I'm doing good. COVID, that just was perfect for this time of the year, what's going on in the world today. Just all of them, I love them. I love the Christmas songs. Larry Got Ran Over by a Reindeer. They're all really good.
I like the nieces and nephews. That's a really cute one, because we have so many nieces and nephews in our family. But I love the Cheyenne, Cousin Cheyenne's one, because I just love the heart, the heart song. But all of them, and every time a new one comes out or something, it's just how fast it becomes so popular and you know, takes off. So, I mean, I like them all. But yeah, if you have to pick your favorites, I mean, I like Nieces and Nephews. Down the Shore is good, you know, so.
Well, the songs are very catchy, so they're always, you can listen and you can remember, and they all get your attention, and they're all about real things. I can't tell you what was my favorite song, because all of them are very good, but I would have to say Just Because I went down when he did the video for Doing Good, that we were down there spending time, so I do like that one.
I actually, you have to listen closely, but in one of the songs, I am the clap that you hear in the background. I was so proud to be the clap. We re-recorded my clap, I think, quite a few times till we got it right, but I was in the song and I was happy. Doing Good has always been my favorite song. Doing good. And anytime that I feel maybe I just had a little rough day or something like that, I just sing that song to myself, because it makes me feel like I'm doing good, and you're gonna do good, and you can be good, and just that's just a song that I find that I sing and would be my favorite. Nieces and Nephews too as well. I mean, I love them all in their own way, but I think Doing Good is my favorite.
I think when Troy first came to me to record some music for Aunt Mary Pat, like, I felt a lot of pressure to get it right, and to know that that was going to be part of something really important, something bigger than I've ever done personally. Troy's friend, producer, songwriter Ken took a trip from Boston to spend time to get it right, and I'm thinking, like, oh my gosh, I just have like this little mic in my house, this isn't big enough. So I had a past experience at this studio in Newport, and I was like, let's just go here, this guy knows what he's doing, and it went well. But then when you came back to me and said, like, let's make another song, like, I started to get some confidence. And honestly, it was more about working with my brother on a project, on music, that meant more to me than Aunt Mary Pat at first. I didn't really have much context of how it was gonna be used in the shows. So it was just a really special moment. Music means so much to me personally, and to be able to share some of that with my brother was huge. But when, maybe it was at Argilla, when you started using the songs and you gave me a shout out, like during the show, like, and my brother was the one who helped me record this, and like, stand up, like, that's when it became more about Aunt Mary Pat for me and the value that it played on the shows. But at first, and still to this day, like, I get to hang out with my brother and make a song. Like, that's so, it sparks so much joy for me.
Yeah. Well, oh, that is my favorite song. Yes, Nieces and Nephews. I mean, if I had to pick one, it would be Nieces and Nephews. I scream and always beg him to do that song. So he'll like Troy act like he's leaving and then come back and do it. But yeah, I mean, and they're all very good. His songwriter, he does a very good job.
Everything kind of came together, and it was really just an amazing experience. You know, to have that video, have the album coming out. We did a launch party at Timothy's of Westchester, which has been a great partner of mine since the beginning. And, you know, it was just cool. It was really cool. And I was so happy. And, you know, to hear your songs on the radio and have people listen to them and tag you that they're listening to it. And, you know, it was just an incredible experience. And then later that year, we did the Merry Friggin' Christmas album, which it was perfect for me. Like, that was even more fun than the first one, to have my friends, Ian, who plays Rita Marie, and my friend Brittany, who plays my daughter, Kelly. You know, it's just so cool to be able to include your talented friends and also do something that you love. And Ken is just a perfect collaborator to work with, and, you know, really does a great job. And then to work with people you love, you know, the live shows, first of all, would not be possible without my partner, Danny, who sells the merchandise and helps me out. My Aunt Trina, who, you know, is my road dog. You know, she drives me all over and, you know, does an invaluable service for me by keeping me moving, keeping me ready. You know, she's always on the move. We call her the commander, because she's always taking charge. My family for supporting me, you know, my brother, my sister, my mom for being there. You know, my extended family who come out to the shows all the time. Joel for organizing it. And then, you know, the creative people that, you know, do shows with me. You know, after Aunt Mary Pat started, I wanted to craft out this universe, you know, characters. Who are the people in her life? And the first one was my husband, Larry, who my friend Jason Rash plays. And, you know, when he toured with me the most, you know, even went to California with me. And, you know, I just wanted to have this, like, kind of gross but lovable character that was just, like, aloof and Aunt Mary Pat's punching bag, but you kind of, like, felt for him. And then it was her asshole daughter, Kelly, who is my friend Brittany. And she is just an amazing singer, talent. She fit into the role perfectly. You know, her and I hit it off, like, family right away. My friend Ian, who plays Brittany Lynn, and Ian has a huge career in Philadelphia as a drag queen named Brittany Lynn. And Ian played Rita Marie, and that was, you know, a combination of his life growing up in South Philly and, like, who these characters would be friends with and what they would talk about. And then we had my best friend David, who plays my cousin Cheyenne. And that was just, like, you know, that's just fun to be around your best friend and, like, do stupid things and have these, you know, things happen together. And then I met a wonderful performer named Matthew, who plays my mom, Charlene Delizio. And 100%, you know, I saw him do a character and I was like, you know what, you'd be perfect to play my mom. And then, you know, the two skits that we did together, you know, he wrote and outlined, and, you know, it was just perfect. And I'm so happy that I'm able to include, you know, so many talented people in the show. And I'm so grateful that everything falls into place when it does, because I would not have been able to do this when I was 20 years old. I would not be responsible enough. But at, you know, at 30, when it happened, you know, it became the right time for everything.
What a night. We had an amazing show. Almost 300 people outside. Just wonderful, wonderful, wonderful. You always feel better when you're doing a big show. The energy's good, everything felt good. It was, I don't know, it's great.
So coming up next, I would just love to keep performing. I would love to, you know, really stretch my talents and, you know, combine Aunt Mary Pat and drag and my characterizations and my impersonation videos and all this kind of stuff. I would really love to expand on that. A dream job would obviously to be on Saturday Night Live. I think that is, like, I mean, hands down, that would be the perfect situation or job for me. But whatever comes next, I'm grateful and I'm thankful for, and I know it would not have been possible without my family and without the success of Aunt Mary Pat. And for that, I'm eternally grateful, always. And I can't wait to see what happens next.
Oh, I already said that people start off just like this. You can start off with a little character, and then next thing you know, you're a TV show, or you're doing comedy out in, you know, Los Angeles or whatever. You know, I always told Troy that Mike Myers started the same way. You know, he started with his little character, and then now look at him.
Like I said earlier, you know, I knew since I was 5 or 6 years old that Troy has a really special talent to, first of all, be able to reach out and grab something, know that the world is his and he can manipulate it. And to see that take place, Troy was doing a lot of jobs that paid the bills, but I knew that he wanted more and would kind of do entertainment on the weekends. And to see that he's able to make a living out of this and bring so much joy to people and bring voices to people through Aunt Mary Pat that normally would just kind of show up and do their job is really beautiful. And I feel a lot of pride being Troy's brother and being able to take my art and bring it into his world. I think that's really beautiful. I'm sort of a quiet person who doesn't want to bump into the walls too much. And Troy is the opposite. And even if just a sprinkle of that energy rubs off on me, is more than I could ever ask for. And if you haven't seen one of his shows yet, I hope that you make time to experience that, because it's you know, you can hear about it all day, but it's really special to be in the same room as Troy, whether it's Troy or Aunt Mary Pat or Miss Troy. And you know, I've hit the lottery of who my brother is, and and I hope that the world sees how special he is.
Oh, bigger and better shows and just getting it out there to even more people. I mean, it's already out there, but this world right now and everything that we are going through, people need people like you who make them happy and give them things to look forward to.
Final thoughts is I am proud of Troy. I seen him going out for what he wants, and he does a great job, me being his aunt. I love to see him go on and live his dreams, and that is what I would love him to do.
I hope Aunt Mary Pat gets on like a show. I really do, because behind the scenes, Troy works very hard. So does Aunt Mary Pat. Like I said, I hope some kind of show comes out of this. That's what I'm really hoping for.
And did you have any final thoughts that you want to share?
Just I hope this keeps going on. Like I said, it's getting stronger. Even through COVID, he's made his way through COVID. I just hope Aunt Mary Pat never dies. I just hope Aunt Mary Pat goes on forever. Like I said, I hope it might get a TV series or something out of it. That's what I'm hoping and praying for.
I just want to close and take time to thank every single person who supported Aunt Mary Pat, who loved Aunt Mary Pat, who watched, commented, viewed, shared anything since I've been doing this, bought a ticket. And I know, and I say it at every show, and I appreciate you spending your hard-earned money to support me and to be a part of the experience. I want to thank my family for sharing openly and honestly about their experiences and supporting me and being there for me and really taking the time to just be my rocks and truly support me. I had to thank my manager Joel, because without him I would not have a professional career. Like, I truly, truly, truly got bulldozed several times, and he really always came to my defense on my side, and I owe him a debt of gratitude. I want to thank my partner, Danny, and our two kids, Liam and Bella, for just, you know, keeping me grounded during this crazy, crazy time and this crazy career. I love them more than anything in the world. I have to thank my friends for always being there for me and, you know, lifting up my spirits and I don't know, not treating me any different because my career is different. I want to thank everyone who told me I couldn't do it, who said that I would never, you know, do anything in the entertainment world, who I would never be successful. I had a person tell me, "You'll never work in Philadelphia again." Well, baby, look at me now. And I truly just, I thank my cats because I love them. And I thank you, the viewer. Thank you for watching this and being a part of this journey. And I cannot wait to see what's next. Thank you. Losing. Oh, there's my cat. Isabel, stop. And now can you say for the audience, stop it now.
Stop it now. Yin's gotta go.
That's the end. You did good.
Stop. I didn't know Cheyenne was based off my looseness.
No, I said loosely based off you, not based on your looseness. This is what happens when you try to do things at home.
Love you, Evie.
What's your favorite thing about family parties?
The drama.
We fought over it. I don't care if it was you in the paper or not. That was my paper and you need to find your own because I've saved every clip, every article, everything just because of how proud I am. But I think I ended up winning, but later down the line, I think I ended up giving in and feeling guilty and gave you the copy, which I now regret because I don't have it.